Hello. Good evening. For those of you who don't know, I'm Deborah Lucas. I'm the director of the MIT Center for Finance and Policy. It's my pleasure to welcome you tonight to our second annual conference this year on the topic of financial products and policies for an aging population. It's really fantastic to see you all here. Retirement finance is a topic that's particularly well suited to CFP's mission, which is in part to foster dialogue between leading practitioners, policymakers, and academics on major financial challenges that governments are confronted with. We hope that this conference will be an opportunity for some of those conversations to take place, and I can hear that they're all going on now. But we also hope that it will be a catalyst for future research that continues long after this conference is over. I don't want to talk too long tonight, but I have to say that it's my enormous pleasure and privilege to introduce our keynote speaker and my good friend, Dr. Douglas Elmendorf. First, I'll give you a little bit of his formal bio, but then I will be feel compelled to say a few other things too. Doug is currently a visiting fellow at Brookings, and he modestly insisted that we list that as his affiliation. But more impressively, starting this January, he'll be the dean of the John F. Kennedy School of Government at Harvard University. Prior to that, Doug served as the director of the Congressional Budget Office from 2009 through 2015, where he presided over all kinds of important things. Going back further, other appointments include that he was the director of Brookings' Hamilton Project, he was an assistant professor at Harvard, he was a principal analyst at CBO, now we're really going back, a senior economist at the White House Council of Economic Advisors, a deputy assistant secretary for economic policy at the Treasury Department, and an assistant director of the Division of Research and Statistics at the Federal Reserve Board. So in all of these positions, Doug worked on budget policy, on healthcare issues, the macroeconomic effects of fiscal policy, Social Security, income security programs, financial markets, macroeconomic analysis and forecasting, and a wide range of other issues, all of which truly give him a deep and unique perspective on tonight's topic. Unfortunately, his degrees are not from MIT, but he did earn his PhD and master's degree in economics from Harvard University, where he was a National Science Foundation graduate fellow, and he has an AB summa cum laude from Princeton University. But on a more personal note, I would say that one way to really learn a lot about someone is to work for them. And Doug was my boss at CBO when I returned there in 2009 in the wake of the financial crisis to work with him on setting up a new financial analysis division. So apart from being an outstanding economist and a crystal clear thinker, Doug is amazing personally. He's unfailingly fair, honest, high-minded, hardworking, and importantly, very kind. He's an amazing individual, and he's been an important role model for me personally. Just to give you an anecdote about his saintly qualities, some of my great memories were sitting in his office where you could actually hear a congressman screaming at him through a phone. And everyone in the room could kind of hear the screaming, and that would go on for a while, and he would put the phone down, and then we'd go back to whatever report we were sketching out for CBO. Just, you know, not a word, just perfect. So anyway, Doug, we're thrilled that you're going to be our neighbor down the road. I hope that leads to many productive collaborations between the CFP and the Kennedy School, and we're very privileged to have you here talking to us tonight, so thank you.
Thank you, Debbie. That is a really excessively generous and rather embarrassing introduction. I learned a tremendous amount from the chance I had to work with Debbie at the Congressional Budget Office. and it was a terrible loss for CBO and very sad for me personally when she left. But I knew that she had other important things to do in the world, and you are here as part of that. I am delighted that this center has attracted such a terrific group of researchers and supporters and is doing such interesting and consequential research. And I am honored to be here with you tonight. I want to give you my perspective on federal policies for our graying population. Older Americans are supported by a combination of public programs and private resources, and we need to make significant changes in federal policies toward both. And that is my topic for tonight. Before discussing specific policies, though, I want to set the table. There are four developments in this country that are tremendously important for the available policy choices, and I think for the appropriate policy choices. And these developments won't surprise you, but they deserve emphasis to start. First, we are at the beginning of a surge of people into retirement. By 2025, there will be roughly 70 million beneficiaries of Social Security and Medicare, about 60% more people than the number in 2007 before the first baby boomers became eligible for early retirement benefits. Those 70 million beneficiaries in 2025 will represent about one-fifth of the U.S. population. And as you know, this share will continue to increase after 2025, albeit more slowly. We are not experiencing a temporary graying of the U.S. population, but a permanent demographic change. And the key implication for federal policies is that getting policies toward an aging population right is hugely important in both economic and social terms. The second crucial development is that the incomes of people across most of the income distribution have risen quite slowly during the past few decades, while incomes at the high end of the distribution have risen very rapidly. Most people in the country have gained very little directly from the growth in overall output and income for a number of years. Tax and transfer policies have benefited people in the lower parts of the income distribution, but nonetheless, their income has grown much more slowly than incomes of people at the top. And the key implication, to my mind, is that changes in federal policies should protect people of modest means by imposing most of the burden of the changes on affluent people. And I will discuss how much that matters for policy choices. The third development is that changes in labor markets are significantly reducing the role of traditional employer-provided retirement benefits. There's been a flurry of interest recently in the so-called gig economy, in which people do specific tasks for specific firms without establishing ongoing employment relationships. But the extent of the gig economy, I think, is unclear. The bigger issue is really people who move between traditional relationships with employers, or people who stay at a traditional employer but don't receive the kind of benefits that people would have received a few decades ago. And the most important example, I think, is the decline in defined benefit pension plans. These changes in labor markets have two implications, I think, for federal policies. One is that the portability of benefits between employers has become especially important. And the other is that other sources of retirement benefits, namely personal saving and federal programs, are becoming more important. And the fourth development to highlight is that federal debt, relative to the size of the economy, is very high by historical standards and will increase over the next few decades without significant policy changes. Federal debt is now 74% of GDP, compared with an average of 38%, roughly half, over the past 50 years. And CBO's long-term baseline shows debt rising further to exceed 100% of GDP in 25 years. Economists do not know what the optimal amount of federal debt is, but one can make a strong case that we should plan to gradually reduce the debt-GDP ratio rather than allowing it to rise, as it will, without changes in policies. And since benefits for older Americans represent the largest share of federal spending today, and the largest share of growth in federal spending unless policies are changed, the fiscal challenge runs squarely up against the challenge of providing adequate support for people in retirement. And the key implication is that federal resources are particularly scarce and need to be directed at their most valuable uses. So with those four developments in mind, let me explain the sorts of changes that I would make in three key areas of federal policy: Social Security, Medicare, and tax incentives for personal saving. And then I'll touch briefly on some other policy areas and conclude. For Social Security, I think we should make the trust funds sustainable for 75 years, primarily by reducing benefits for high-income beneficiaries and raising payroll taxes on workers with high earnings, not by making significant across-the-board cuts in benefits or by using general revenues. Let me explain why. We should make the program sustainable without general revenues, meaning revenues from elsewhere the government collects that aren't targeted at Social Security, because I think financing government programs with dedicated sources of funds has great advantages in terms of political economy. From a pure economics perspective, focusing on Social Security in isolation from the rest of the federal government's activities does not make a lot of sense. And including trust funds that can accumulate balances in a budget that basically tracks annual cash flows makes no accounting sense and leads to almost hopelessly confused discussions about double counting in the budget and whether the government is actually pre-funding Social Security benefits. So the analysts who focus on the entire federal budget have the economics just right. But this is not only a matter of economics. Linking certain taxes to certain spending improves people's understanding of where their tax dollars are going, and that facilitates a more constructive public debate about the levels of taxes and spending that we want to have as a society. That understanding is really important, especially at a time when pervasive misunderstanding of the budget has been a real obstacle to a constructive public debate. Now, I'm not pretending that dedicated funding is a panacea that will necessarily achieve good governance. If it were, we would quickly agree to raise the gasoline tax to the inflation-adjusted level that it was at 20 years ago, and we would use that money as a straightforward user fee to finance highway spending that almost everyone seems to want, and we have not done that. But I do think that linking taxes to benefits gives us at least a fighting chance of having a good, constructive debate about how high we want taxes and benefits to be. So I support the sort of dedicated financing that we see in Social Security for that reason. The specific goal I mentioned of sustainability for 75 years is, of course, a bit arbitrary, but that is the traditional planning horizon for Social Security, and it's in the right ballpark in terms of the effects on the overall budget. Suppose that our goal was to bring down the debt-to-GDP ratio gradually over the next 40 years to what it has been over our history. Then the changes needed to achieve this 75-year sustainability in Social Security would probably amount to about a quarter of the total budgetary changes needed, which seems reasonable in an entirely non-scientific way. I think we should reach this target without significant across-the-board cuts in benefits, because such cuts would significantly reduce total retirement income for a lot of people who have experienced very slow income growth over the past few decades. I think that would be the wrong place to put that burden. I also think this would be wrong for a few other reasons. One is that a significant number of people are not saving enough for their retirement, even given current law benefits. A second is that a large number of people would have incomes below, of elderly Americans, would have incomes below the poverty line without Social Security benefits. Now, if we cut benefits by a significant amount, then surely some people, at least, would save somewhat more. But the net effect would very likely be an increase in poverty among older Americans. And the third point to emphasize is that Social Security benefits has some very distinctive and important characteristics that are becoming even more important with the decline of defined benefit pensions. Social Security benefits protect against longevity risk by coming in the form of annuities for recipients and their survivors. Social Security benefits impose no financial market risk. And Social Security benefits require no individual self-restraint or planning for retirement. Now, if one wants to achieve long-term sustainability of Social Security without making across-the-board cuts in benefits or bringing in general revenues, then some of the standard arrows in reformers' quivers are not appropriate. For example, increasing the eligibility age for full retirement benefits should be, in my view, a last resort, not a first resort. Instead, I think we should focus on reducing benefits for high-income beneficiaries and raising payroll taxes on workers with high earnings. And there are options of that sort, some that CBO has looked at in the past. Taken together, such targeted reductions in benefits and increases in taxes could eliminate much of the estimated 75-year shortfall in Social Security. Now, I do not want to pretend that this approach offers a free lunch. Making Social Security more progressive would weaken the connection between people's earnings and taxes paid and the benefits they receive. And if taken too far, that would undermine the earned benefit character of the Social Security system. In addition, people with higher incomes would face both higher taxes and lower benefits under the strategy I've suggested, and that would reduce their incentives to work and save. There is an equity efficiency trade-off here, using the language that Arthur Oaken wrote about 40 years ago. But I think this approach is the best available one because it would put Social Security on a sustainable path without unduly burdening those Americans who have fared the worst in economic terms in recent years. Let me turn now to Medicare. For Medicare, I think we should make two broad sorts of changes. One is to increase the role of means testing in the program, and I'll say what I mean by that more specifically. The other is to accelerate ongoing transformations in our society and in Medicare, particularly in the way that we pay for health care. In contrast with Social Security, I'm not going to recommend a specific financial target for Medicare changes, and I won't belabor the reasons, but I can offer them later if you're interested. The rationale for greater means testing in Medicare, the first item I talked about, is the same as for Social Security. We should narrow the projected gap between the benefits that we promised to pay and the taxes that we've legislated to collect. And given the relative income growth of people higher and lower in the income distribution over the past few decades, I think we should impose most of that additional burden on higher income people. To accomplish this, I mentioned a couple of specific items. I would significantly expand what are called income-related premiums in Medicare in Part B. Part B of Medicare covers payments to doctors and most other providers except for hospitals. Today, about 6% of Medicare beneficiaries, Part B beneficiaries, pay more than the standard premium because they have higher income. Under current law, that 6% will rise over time, but only by about half a percentage point per year. And I would significantly expand the number of people who pay those income-related premiums. I would also raise payroll tax rates for higher workers with higher earnings. Again, I want to emphasize, there are trade-offs here. This is not a magic solution, but is the choices that we have to make as a society about where to impose the burden of the cuts in benefits or increases in taxes that we need to put the budget on a sustainable path. And I think those choices need to involve some weighing of the consequences for efficiency, overall economic growth, and for the equity of the burden of government programs. And I'm just trying to be straightforward about the implications that I draw from the recent developments, recent meaning over the past few decades, in incomes across the income distribution in this country. In terms of Medicare's payments for health care, about 30% of Medicare beneficiaries today are enrolled in private insurance plans through a system known as Medicare Advantage. And CBO projects that under current law that 30% today will rise to 40% over the next decade. So this is a large and increasingly large part of the Medicare program. Medicare Advantage involves competition between private insurers, but the structure of the system does not maximize the intensity of that competition, nor create a level playing field between private insurance plans and traditional fee-for-service Medicare. A system known as premium support could be viewed as an expansion of Medicare Advantage and would intensify just that sort of competition. So under premium support, beneficiaries would purchase insurance from either a private insurer or the government-run fee-for-service program. They would pay 100% of any premium amount above a benchmark, if they chose a more expensive plan, and they would save 100% of the savings below that benchmark if they chose a less expensive plan. And with that arrangement, price competition between private insurers and between private insurers and the fee-for-service program would be much stronger than it is under current law. Now, I would, for those who follow this issue, I'll give a little more detail. I would establish a premium support system with two specific characteristics. I would keep the fee-for-service program in place because some people prefer it and because maintaining that system, in fact, intensifies the competition and would hold down costs in ways that CBO explored a few years ago. And I would set the benchmark premiums consistent with the average bid of private insurers and the fee-for-service program, rather than trying to cut that further, essentially as a way of protecting beneficiaries from some of the extra costs. It is nonetheless the case that some beneficiaries would pay much higher premiums under this system than under current law. That's especially beneficiaries who choose fee-for-service in parts of the country where fee-for-service is expensive. In my judgment, that burden is a cost worth bearing for the society to establish a more competitive system. Now, according to CBO's estimates, this sort of system would save some federal dollars and would also reduce costs on average for beneficiaries, although there would be a very wide range of experiences. I also think, in addition to the short-term savings that sort of the CBO estimated, there would be longer-term savings because in this sort of competitive system, there would be more pressure to search for cost-saving changes in medical practice and to stay away from cost-increasing changes, particularly cost-increasing changes that did not have clear benefits to people's health. I also think that the choices beneficiaries would make in this sort of system would provide an important signal of how much they value additional health care. Part of the problem we have today is that because so few people pay for their health care, pay their health insurance premium in a directly visible way, and later pay for health care by paying very much out of pocket, we just have very little sense of how much people actually are willing to give up other sorts of goods and services for health care. And it gives us very little guidance for how our society should operate in terms of encouraging people through the tax and transfer system to take health insurance of different sorts. Even under that sort of system I've suggested, a lot of people will remain in fee-for-service Medicare. So it's crucially important that fee-for-service Medicare look for ways to pay providers that are more efficient than the standard fee-for-service label connotes. And one specific example here is a bundling of payments, a bundled payment rather than Medicare paying each provider who played some role in an episode of care for you. Medicare pays for the entire episode of care to one provider, often the hospital, and then that money is parceled out across the different providers. This can achieve monetary savings, but it also, very importantly, encourages providers to work together. If they're being paid together, it sort of forces more connection between them, and that can improve the coordination of care and make people healthier while it reduces costs. More generally, there's a Center for Medicare and Medicaid Innovation that is experimenting with different payment models, and we should support that with all of the force that we can. And that brings me to the third policy area I want to discuss, which is tax incentives for personal saving. I think we should overhaul those incentives both to increase saving by people who are under-saving and to reduce the federal cost of saving incentives. I think, in fact, we can do both at once. Studies suggest that a significant minority of Americans is not saving enough now. One factor that will actually make saving more difficult in the future is that the rate of return on savings will probably be lower in the future than in the past because the aging of the population, slow productivity growth, and other factors will hold down the return to capital. In CBO's estimates, for example, and this is representative, I think, of other people's thinking on these issues, the interest rate on Treasury debt will average about 2% after adjusting for inflation going forward, compared with about 3% over, say, the 20 years preceding the financial crisis. A pretty significant decline. And most of the factors CBO focuses on projections of Treasury interest rates for reasons you can guess. But most of the factors holding down Treasury rates will, in fact, hold down private rates of return as well. So it'll be harder in some senses, important senses, to save in the future. So we need to encourage more saving. It'll be harder in some ways to accumulate a sufficient nest egg. At the same time, current federal subsidies are not that well targeted. I think reducing federal subsidies for saving is important because the subsidies are quite expensive. They go overwhelmingly to higher income people and may not have a large impact on people saving for all of that. For example, the exclusion from taxation of pension contributions and earnings costs the federal government about $150 billion a year now, including revenue lost from both income taxes and payroll taxes. About 85% of that lost revenue goes to people in the top two quintiles of the income distribution. And many of those people probably reduce other saving to offset much of their pension contributions. It's a large use of resources with very little effect on the things that we care most about. Fortunately, economists are learning ways to increase personal saving that do not rely on substantial federal subsidies. As Raj Chetty discussed in his Eli lecture early this year, there's a growing body of evidence that tax incentives for saving have smaller effects than a variety of nudges, such as defaulting people into saving plans. And various proposals have built on this evidence in suggesting reforms to federal policy with three main elements. First, proposals reduce tax subsidies for large savers by lowering the limits on contributions to tax-favored accounts or lowering the tax rates at which those contributions reduce tax liability. Such a reduction would improve the budget outlook and free up resources to increase retirement saving through other means, probably without much direct effect on the amount of saving or the share of people who are undersaving. And then proposals would use some of that money to strengthen incentives for employers to arrange for retirement savings plans for their employees, to automatically enroll employees in those plans and establish default contributions, and to increase annuitization in those plans. Today, only about half of private sector employees report that their employer even sponsors a retirement plan, and providing additional incentives to employers would probably raise that figure substantially. And third, proposals include other changes to cajole people into doing more retirement saving, such as establishing refundable tax credits for saving contributions, increasing the portability of savings across employers, and so on. I think that implementing a set of reforms along those three lines would be an important improvement in federal policy. Now, before I finish, let me mention just briefly two other policy areas where changes are warranted. One, the Pension Benefit Guarantee Corporation and many state and local pension plans are underfunded. It would be good to address that underfunding sooner rather than later. Two, private long-term care insurance is very limited. As you know, Medicaid pays for long-term care for people who have essentially no income or wealth left. That benefit is costly for governments. The federal portion will exceed $100 billion a year in less than a decade, but still leaves people bearing substantial financial risk themselves. Now, generating a significant increase in private coverage for long-term care will be difficult, in part because of the safety net that Medicaid provides, but it will be very valuable for society, and we should work at it. In sum, older Americans are supported, as I said at the beginning, by a combination of public programs and private resources. To ensure that this support will be sufficient in coming decades for the rapidly growing number of older Americans, we should make significant changes in Social Security, in Medicare, and in tax incentives for private saving. Those changes, in addition to helping those programs' beneficiaries, would go a long way toward putting the federal budget on a more sustainable trajectory. And given the trends in income growth in recent decades, those changes should, in my view, protect people of modest means by imposing most of the burden on affluent people. This is a feasible agenda. I think we should get to it. Thank you very much. Yes? I'm absolutely willing to take any questions. Do the best I can. What did I say you didn't like, or what else do you want me to? Yes, go ahead.
When you talk about the debt burden going forward, and you also talk about interest rates going down, is it the magnitude of the debt or the debt service that you need? I mean, should we really be focused on the debt service rather than the magnitude of the debt?
Well, given the rise in federal debt, the fact that interest rates will probably be lower reduces federal debt service. And that helps, doesn't help enough to stop the federal debt from rising without end in CBO's projections. So in some sense, something has to be done. Those projections are at all right. Something has to be done at some point. And it is better not to wait until the crisis hits to do that. So how far down you want to push federal debt, that's a question that economists don't have a crisp answer to. But I think the case for trying to return it closer to our historical average is that doing so would increase the scope for private investment because the federal government would be absorbing a smaller share of the funds available in the economy. But also, reducing debt would give us the flexibility in the future to cut taxes to stimulate the economy or raise spending to fight a war or stabilize the financial system or something else. And that kind of fiscal space is lost if we're already running with a quite high debt.
I guess the question is debt service the thing we should be focused on rather than the magnitude of the debt?
I think we should focus on the magnitude of debt. And the reason is because I think the interest rates, as you know, can move around a lot. So if one says, well, we have a lot of debt, but it's okay because rates are low, we can wake up in a pretty short period of time and find that rates are a lot higher. Not that I'm predicting that at this moment, and I wouldn't even predict to some people in this room for whose predictions I would rather hear than offer mine. But that is a risk. So I think the danger in running around with a high debt but feeling okay because rates are low now and interest, so debt service is low, is that might not persist. I think that's the reason we should focus on bringing the debt down to a more traditional level for this country.
So some of your proposal flies in the face of some of the budgetary concepts that folks in Washington hold with evangelical fervor. Do you think the budget process needs to be completely rethought in order to achieve your vision?
So I don't think so. Social Security, as you know, has traditionally been a focus on the 75-year projections for the Social Security trust funds. That has coexisted with a focus on the unified federal budget. And part of the problem is that those two concepts do not fit together at all well. And that fundamental inconsistency is only solvable through some much more dramatic transformation of how we keep our books than I would really take the time to try to propose. I just don't think that's changeable. But I think the conflict between the trust fund accounting and the unified budget accounting was particularly acute at a point when Social Security was building up large balances. That's not the issue now. The issue is going to be trying to keep up with the benefit payments. So I think as a practical matter, the conflict in these accounting systems will be somewhat smaller in the future. And I think it's appropriate for most of the budget process to continue to focus on the unified budget that is the right concept. Where we have particular programs with existing dedicated taxes, I think we should sustain that because I think it increases public understanding of what's going on and then increases the chance of better public decisions. The reason I didn't have a financial target for Medicare is because Medicare is a very odd combination of a trust fund with dedicated financing that can run out and is projected to run out in 15 years, and another trust fund that pays for other kinds of health care that cannot run out because general revenues are infused whenever they're needed. So that's almost impossible to keep track of in a rational way. So I think there's a lot of unified budget we should keep using, but I think where we can link up benefits and taxes in a natural way, that is important. That is definitely not the standard economist's line, but as I mentioned, I think the standard economist's line misses the importance from a political economy perspective of helping people understand, non-budget experts understand where the money's going and where it's coming from. Yes, Peter.
Both your Social Security and your Medicare ideas, you've got both the means testing and the wage tax. What's your intuition, given the demographic profile you've described and we're all aware of, about the ratio between the two? That is, how much are you going to get, given the demographic profile, how much are you going to have to get from means testing of benefits versus what you're going to actually get by taxing the high wage earners?
I don't have a simple answer to that. I did look at a set of specific proposals that CBO had estimated a few years ago, and there are pretty significant savings to be achieved by this sort of benefit cuts targeted at people higher in distribution, and pretty significant revenues to be gained by raising taxes on higher wage earners. And I deliberately did not go so far as to say this is the precise Elmendorf plan. I don't think that's that useful or that interesting in some sense. So I tried to offer more broad prescriptions. I don't really have that clear view about the benefit tax breakdown. And I think, in fact, that distinction is sometimes overweighted in the political debate. So from an economist's point of view, one can think of many sorts of transfer programs as negative taxes in their economic effects. So taking money from somebody at a high income and giving it to somebody at a lower income, that may be a tax collection and a benefit provided. But economically, they're the same thing, and they have the same effects, which is the tax, higher tax on higher income people reduces their earnings, and more generous benefits to lower income people will reduce their earnings. So in some level, it's not so much whether we want higher taxes or lower spending. It's more about whether we're trying, and you know this, it's more about whether we're trying to, which generations we're trying to affect, how quickly we want to make certain changes. So for my purposes, I would do a significant amount of both, but I don't have a split in mind. Yeah, Andrew.
I'm very much not a politician, just coming at this purely as an economist, trying to think about what the age at which you start to receive retirement should be. And I worry very much that we've set some numbers and they've become sacred and they're meaningless in any bigger sense and they're completely inappropriate and we have absolutely no way politically of even running a discussion of what the appropriate age would be. And I saw you kind of very much wanted to avoid that because you're aware that saying, by God, you know, we're living 7 years longer, maybe we could retire 6 months later, just isn't palatable. But at some point, we're gonna have to absolutely grasp that question of what's the age.
Right, so you're right. I have a few thoughts on that topic. One is that the full retirement age in Social Security is not the point at which most people claim benefits. They claim it at age 62. So one way to think about raising retirement age from 65, well, it's going up to 67, of course, now, right? So it's already en route from the 1983, I think, Greenspan Commission proposed an increase that was then enacted by Congress to raise retirement age, the full age for full benefits from 65 to 67. And we're not quite there yet, but when I get there, 67 will be the age. Now, should we go further? Well, again, the issue is people don't wait till they're 67. They tend to retire at 62, and they get less benefits because of that. So in some ways, the way to think about any further increase from 67 to 68 is not as sort of cutting benefits by 1 year, but cutting benefits by 7% or 8%. Excuse me?
You could have moved 62.
Yeah, so I'm coming to that. So the age people talk most about is raising 67 to 68. And that has some value in sort of fixing people around a number, but mostly it should be viewed as just, I guess, like 7 or 8% cut in benefits at any given age that you still choose to retire at. So that's the sense in which it really is an across-the-board cut in the level of benefits more than it is a signal of the right age. Now you could raise you could raise 62, and when CBO analyzed this a few years ago, we looked at the difference it effects of raising the age for full benefits and the age for early eligibility. And if you raise the 62 to 63 or 64 or whatever, then that would have a greater effect, I think, on when people actually chose to retire. So should we raise that age? And I did duck past that. I think it's complicated, and I would probably support an increase in that age sort of at the bottom of the list of things I would do. So part of what you heard me say was I didn't want to make these things the first resort. I want to make them the last resort. But I also think it's complicated because the increase in longevity is not uniform across the income distribution. I don't I keep coming back to that topic, but it's an important one. I think it was the piece today or yesterday in the paper by Peter Orszag, my predecessor as CBO director, highlighting this. There's been a greater divergence in mortality for people of different income levels. So although most of us in this room will live longer than our predecessors would have some time ago, that is less true in a significant way for lower middle-income people. And so that makes it more comp. So an increase in early eligibility age, that is, in a sense, hitting lower middle-income people more. Doesn't mean we should never do it, but that's a reason why I put it low on my list. Other questions? Yes.
Your point about reducing the tax incentives for saving, it seems to me one of the benefits of it isn't necessarily getting people to save more, but it gives you a useful policy lever on the back end when people actually retire and want to spend down, a useful way to get people to buy annuities or even have an optimal spend down. So if you're giving that up, do you have a plan for to sort of encourage people to annuitize some other way?
Yes, I mean, I don't, but people do. So let me try to explain. The things I talked about were not taking away these tax provisions. It was reducing their scope. So I talked about reducing the amount that could be contributed, reducing the tax benefit of that. I think those reductions would primarily affect people with a lot of money to save, who I think are more likely to be doing careful planning to have retirement advisors. Not all of them, they won't get it all right, but I think it's less of a problem. What I'm more concerned about is the lack of financial acumen and the lack of ability to hire financial advice for people with less to save. And I think the way you try to approach that is by trying to encourage employers to set up retirement plans and then making it, giving the employers incentives to set up annuitization options. And there's a work of this sort, one of my future colleagues at the Kennedy School, Bridget Madrian, has done work of just this sort. And her view, and she's much more expert than I am, but her view of this is that it is quite possible to significantly increase annuitization through rule changes and through incentives for employers. I think it's absolutely crucial. It's just a huge issue. And again, that's the thing that Social Security gets right, other things don't. So I think it is addressable, but it's not, I think it's not by giving so much a reward to individuals who annuitize. It is giving rewards to employers. It's lowering the costs for them in administrative ways and giving some incentive for them to set that up in retirement plans that they have arranged for their employees. I think the question about the optimal spend down is very complicated because if you give somebody advice and it's bad advice, that can be a pretty big, and you're the government, that's a pretty big problem. So I wouldn't quite go there, but I think annuitization is quite important. Yes, sir.
Since you brought up the retirement plan and encouraging people to annuitize, I ran a, still do to a certain extent, a small business for a long time. And we don't have the wherewithal to set up that apparatus in-house. However, we relied on the larger financial institutions. In our case, Vanguard, for instance, I think there is a representative from Vanguard here. He may want to comment, or she may want to comment. And it would seem to me that the employer certainly should be informed and should perhaps make the selection of a financial institution like Vanguard based in good part on there being an availability within a Vanguard or Fidelity or a T. Rowe Price to adopt this, as opposed to a traditional, you know, you can put money into this mutual fund or that.
Yes, I certainly agree. Jim?
So you talked about Social Security. You didn't say anything about disability insurance. And that, you know, for the lower part of the income distribution, DI is increasingly the transition path to the Social Security at 62. It's also financially in tougher straits than the Social Security old age part. What would be the Elmendorf plan proposal for disability insurance?
That's a harder, I ducked that for a good reason, Jim. That's a much harder question. So the serious reason I ducked it is because it is less an issue for older Americans in the sense of over age 62. It is much more an issue is a very important issue for people in their 50s. For those who don't know, there's been a tremendous growth in the number of people receiving disability insurance, Social Security disability insurance, and in the amount of money being spent on disability insurance benefits. Some of that, and there are a number of factors that have explained this change over the last few decades. Some of that is simply that more women are in the labor force and have now aged to a point where people are more likely to have disability. So some of this is just a delayed reflection of some things that pushed up the labor force some decades ago. But important change, there are other important issues. One is there have been some legislative changes that have broadened the definition of disability to include things that are harder to judge and thus more susceptible to the judgment of the physicians and the government apparatus that's determining disability. And there's a tremendous variation across the country in what share of disability applicants are approved for disability benefits that seems to researchers quite hard to justify as a rational response to differences that in the population. It is much more, I think, an inconsistency in standards. A further factor, actually, is that disability insurance benefits are geared to average wages, or average covered wages, at least. So, and because we've had a widening of the wage distribution, disability benefits have risen with the average. People who are below average who've had weaker wage growth, disability benefits have become a larger relative to their wages. And thus, when one is somewhat disabled, but not totally disabled, and one is deciding whether to stay in the workforce or if one loses a job to find another job versus collecting benefits, that balance has been shifted in an important way toward collecting disability benefits. So there's a lot of money is spent here. Obviously, a large number of these people are very much in need of support. Probably not all of them are. Moreover, it's not just a matter of going in, it's also getting out. And in fact, almost nobody gets out of disability insurance except by aging into Social Security retirement benefits or in some cases passing away. But there's almost nobody who gets better in the sense of leaving the system. So we have a lot of problems with this system. There are a lot of other countries, as you know, that have experimented with different ways of handling disability insurance. That's a tricky business. So a standard thing people say is, well, rather than having this be an either-or decision in which you either are in the system or not, let's provide some support, say, to employers who try to keep disabled workers in the workforce by providing certain accommodations. So at CBO, we had a colleague who couldn't see very well at all, and he had a screen like this and special tools, and he wanted to work, and we kept him working. The problem with that sort of partial solution, then, is that lots of people who might go into disability insurance won't, but lots of other people who would not have gone into disability insurance will go into partial disability insurance. So my own view of this is that we need to find a way to establish much more consistent standards across the country, and that we should work harder to keep people in the labor force, in a sense, even for its own sake, whether or not it saves government spending by a lot, because it's better to have people working if they can, then not working. But I don't think we have, when CBO's work on this topic, we had a sort of basic menu of cutting benefits in various ways that we could estimate the effects of. And then we had a sort of wish list of proposals that would be nice to understand better. And I think really a lot of this rests on the shoulders of researchers here and elsewhere affiliated with the NBR and universities to learn more about this. But I don't have a good solution beyond that. Well, I'm here on. I had a nice dinner, so I'm good. Yes.
Have you studied any other countries' models, and are there things you know? Is there a model that you think is one that you would want to sort of copy if you could?
I've studied other countries a bit. There are people who study them much more carefully than I have, and I don't know much about that. I think that. So I have no other particular country in mind. I don't think we should be like country X. I think one needs to be sensitive to underlying differences in the way countries' economies and societies work. So in healthcare, for example, there are most developed countries have more centralized government control of the healthcare system than we have. And they spend less money on healthcare. And they live longer. So that set of facts together incline some people toward a more government-run system. My own view about the US is that we just don't want the government playing that larger role. The Affordable Care Act, which was not a government takeover of the healthcare system, has nonetheless been described that way many, many times. And I think that provides an important signal of what would happen if we actually had a government takeover of the healthcare system. So my view is that between the choices of using more centralized control to run the healthcare system or stimulating more competition in the healthcare system, I think for us, the feasible options really are on the competitive side, which is why I pushed those. So not something, obviously, these are all judgment calls. I'm trying to be clear, this is not some matter of science. But that's part of why I think one has to be careful. Maybe this is a bad excuse for being ignorant, but that's part of why I would be careful, even if I knew more, I think, in trying to adopt things wholesale from other places. Like I mentioned this for disability insurance, but I think that is an area where a variety of countries have done very different things. And I think there is more to learn from them, but I just don't know enough of the details myself. I take one more question. Yes, sir.
Just to follow up on this point, the Australian model is a very interesting control experience, which kind of addresses the linkage between in this sort of like high income, low income issue. So in 20 plus or minus years, the Australian model has said, okay, everybody in the entire country has to contribute 9.5% of their income to an account, which is effectively a defined contribution account, and it follows them wherever they go. And in that period of time, a country of 25 million people or so has created the fourth largest retirement fund market in the world. And everybody, you know, it automatically changed everybody's thinking to say, I'm not gonna take from somebody else and that's gonna be mine. Everybody's in the same game with the same kind of skin in the game, so to speak. So, I mean, I'm kind of curious why, you know, we can't look at such a model and say, hey, look, this is an interesting alternative to the class warfare that we're trying to establish here. And it sort of makes a little bit more sense to me that, and then that's kind of one point. The other point is just on your comment about why there's a bias between taking Social Security at 62 and 65. Every time I've looked at the problem and advised people, the idea was that if you choose 62, you lock in your benefits and it can't be cut back. Whereas if you wait, you know, you're giving the government an option to cut your benefits between age 62 and 65. So that you better take it in and lock it, because everybody's so, you know, unsure of the system that, you know, they're sort of this bias toward taking it to 62 just because you take the chance that they're going to cut your benefits or extend the age from 65 to 67 or whatever. So
those are two great questions. I'll do the second one first. As a legal matter, the benefits are not locked in. Congress could pass a law tonight that would change benefits tomorrow. So the question, as you understand, is what we think is politically feasible.
Once you lock in your benefits, what politician's going to say, if you're currently receiving benefits, we're going to cut you back, but we can always raise the age from 65 to 67.
So I agree that we're not going to cut benefits for people who've already started to claim them, but I also think we're not going to cut benefits for people who are over age 62 anyway. So the proposals that have been made to change Social Security generally grandfather anybody who's over some age, like 60 or even 55. So it's possible. I mean, you're right. There is an option. The sign of the effect, I entirely agree with you. I think as a practical matter, it's not a very large risk. You will note we've had a set of years now with a pretty intense discussion about the government budget and what might be done. And there's been no proposals to raise the retirement age now. Right? And there's proposals to raise it later. People are pretty careful. So Paul Ryan, for example, who I've worked with quite a bit, would like to change Social Security in fundamental ways over time. But his own proposals have done this with a considerable lag. And when he's acted as the chairman of the budget committee, Social Security retirement age has actually not been in the budget resolutions. So I think it's possible, but I think quantitatively, it's not a very large shot. As for the Australian approach you proposed, I think what I would say is what I tried to encourage here was the view that we have ways to at least encourage people to do more retirement saving themselves. So one might view the Australian example here as a very strong version of that. We don't just provide incentives for employers to set up accounts and to annuitize them and so on. We say, guess what? Like, everybody has to do it. And the employers could set it up, or we could set it up in the government in some way. I guess I view that as a stronger version. I don't, my concern that that's too strong a version, but I wouldn't personally rule out what you propose. I think there's still the question of how much, which problems that solves. And I think for people who are living more hand to mouth, saying we're going to take 9% of your income and put it aside, I understand the logic of that, but that's a pretty big burden on them because they won't have a lot of income they would have, from their standards, a lot of income they would have otherwise. So I think as a political matter, this goes back to this question of how we want to impose this burden. And there is a clear, I certainly take your point, there's a real logic to saying that people should save more for themselves. Again, I'm trying to encourage that. Whether we want to force that on people who have very little to save, very little available to save, is a judgment call. And I can see the arguments for that, but I'm more for my part, I'm more concerned about the burdens.
A rate that's being extracted from everybody's paycheck already, which is highly regressive for the poor people.
So it's 12.5% for Social Security, and then another few percent for Medicare, combined employer and employee.
So 12.5 is still greater than 9.
All right, but that 12.5 is paying today's benefits, right? So this is the problem with having a system that is on paper, you're earning benefits, you'll get paid later, but in practice is mostly collecting revenue to pay benefits. So this is the issue about establishing individual accounts that I wrestled with quite a bit, actually, in the late 1990s in one of my numerous assignments, and Marty Feldstein and others have wrestled with, is that you're using those dollars to pay today's benefits. So to have set aside extra dollars for future benefit, for my future benefits, you'd have to take more from my paycheck. OK, I think I've worn you all out with this. Thank you very, very much.